So thank you for the invitation. Very happy to be here. And I will talk about this research that I made several years ago. And I hope it will be clear for you. I will try to simplify and also in order to present this topic, I will also show you some clips from early cinema, from the beginnings of film history. So the aim of this presentation is to analyze the figure of the cinematographic spectator that emerged at the dawn of the 20th century in a social context transformed by technological modernity, the second industrial revolution, and the development of mass culture. It can be noted in this regard that as a means to describe the cinematic experience, a number of discourses drew upon representations inspired by what I call the imaginary of the nervous body that were being circulated at that time in several fields of knowledge and popular culture. Spectators of the first projections were described as akin to hysterics and depicted as being prey to hallucinations, automatism, perceptual disturbances, drowsiness, or mimetic behavior. The spectator was thus depicted as vulnerable to images and to his or her environment, becoming an impressionable and mimetic subject in the process. Thus, I would like to do what I would like to do is to analyze the imaginary of the nervous body of filmgoers by drawing upon two key psychiatric notions that were broadly used at that time: hysteria and hypnosis, or somnambulism, or sleepwalking. Two complementary states that provide the definition of the effects of film and of the cinematographic dispositive on the audience, while also characterizing a model of subjectivity which is representative of modernity. The nervous body first appeared in the medical field at the end of the 19th century, when doctors, psychologists, psychiatrists, and neurologists noticed an outbreak of diseases affecting the nervous system. I show you one of the first medical films recording a crisis of a woman suffering from hysteria, this crisis being provoked by the doctors themselves through hypnosis, to which these patients were very prone.
Thank you.
This nervous body was defined mainly in terms of an increased susceptibility to stimuli, such as hypnosis, which was used to start hysterical crises for the so-called needs of scientific observations. What it is interesting to note is that the nervous disorders were routinely attributed to the dysfunctions of modernity and its technological advancement. When describing the etiology of disorders such as hysteria and neurasthenia, many medical studies took into account factors related to social environment. People living in the big cities were in particular seen as vulnerable to various kinds of neuroses in comparison to people living in the country. Considered to be part of the factors generating nervous disorders, the fruit of modern technology, such as the train, the tramway, electricity, the cinema, and so on, were held responsible for transformation of the psychic apparatus, seen variously as a progress or as a regrettable sign of degeneration. Like urban modernity, film projections were seen as the neurotic spectacle par excellence, as it is able to electrifying, hallucinating, and hypnotizing its audience. This particular conception of the cinematic spectator as a nervous body lent itself easily to technophobic discourses voiced by those groups of society that were increasingly concerned by the impact of modernity on the body as well as on the mind, such as doctors, lawyers, educators, scientists, and so on. Let us now take a closer look at the ways in which the imaginary of the nervous body appear in the field of cinema. This imaginary, which emerged in many areas related to science as well as popular culture, pervaded the field of cinema via cinematic representation itself, but also via textual sources that deal with the effect of film projection on the body and on the mind of viewers. I would argue that the spectatorship that dominates the first years of film projections can be seen as a combination between a mild form of hysteria and a light hypnotic state, a combination that it's not really pathological. As Rebert Gordon has shown, many films made at that time represent characters with nervous disorders, starting with hallucinations that were very common in patients suffering from hysteria. Let's watch together clips taken from movies of Georges Méliès, movies in which the characters have hallucinations provoked by chemical products, such as L'hallucination de l'alchimiste. So the hallucination is treated in the same manner than the dreams or visions at that time. It's not a particular treatment, formal treatment. Another example of hallucination, pharmaceutic. And the hallucinations look like ghosts, literally. So the theme of hallucination is very common at that time. We found it in many other movies, and not only from Georges Méliès. As a form of mass entertainment, film screenings were part of the popular stage performance of the day, such as the cabaret, the café chantant, the pantomime, Grand Guignol, the circus, and so on. These popular shows were influenced by theories about the contemporary forms of neuroses to the point of partaking of an aesthetics of mental illness that was very much in fashion in the artistic sphere. The reason why the body language of convulsions, twitches, and grimaces was so much in vogue in cabarets and café chantants was the popularization of scientific knowledge pertaining to hypnosis, hysteria, and sleepwalking that provided the general public with spectacular images of the nervous body. And we have another example here with Mademoiselle Becca, painted by Edgar Degas. One famous dance in particular allowed the expression of the nervous body seen here in these example as a critique of the aristocratic manners of high society. Let's watch a movie again from Georges Méliès, Le Cakewalk Infernal. So we see first demonic figures that are very common in the movies at that time, and then dancer from the cakewalk appear on the stage, feminine dancer. These dancers are then joined by a couple of black dancers who, in fact, are white dancers, but painted in black, the face painted in black. We see the great flexibility of the bodies dancing, cakewalk. That can be seen as a hysteric dance. again, Georges Méliès, always appearing in his movies. The cakewalk was a dance developed in the late 19th century, generally at get-togethers on slave plantations in the southern United States. Originating in slavery and the plantation south, the cakewalk was the sole organized and even tolerated forum for servants to mock their masters and their mannerisms. After having emerged in the world of cabaret and café chantant, the aesthetic of pathological gestures via the imitation of hysteria and of epileptic seizures found its continuation in early cinema, as for instance comedies and slapstick movie. I will come later on this point. Some movies deal with the topic of the contagion of movement that is central to the theories of the nervous body. Let's see a clip taken from a movie that depicts a dance which has contagious effects on viewers. The film is called La Bouboumi, and it's a movie from Louis Feuillade, a French director. So we see in this movie that the dance can be seen as a metaphor of the film itself, which has hypnotic or fascinating effects or contagious effects. And we see also how live performance is here a metaphor of the filmic experience. At that time, the world of entertainment was heavily influenced by theories of the cerebral unconscious, l'inconscient cérébral, or also called the theories of the double consciousness, that was responsible for automatic behavior, a phenomenon that had remained unexplained until then. The idea of cerebral unconscious is based upon a conception of human psychology as divided between an inferior and a superior ego, the first which is the territory of reflexes and instincts, and the second field of reason is dominated by reason and intellect. All of these possibilities were reenacted over and over again in movies dominated by themes such as decapitation, mutilation, and the expression of instinctual forces, as can be seen in the films of Georges Méliès. Many movies of Méliès make visually concrete the hysterical feeling of dismemberment of the self that is so common to hysterics, along with the figures of automatism, to make up a large part of 19th century shows. And I would like to show you L'Homme Orchestre, where we can see as how the body of Méliès himself, who is the L'Homme Orchestre, multiply itself. And at that time, there is many hysterical patients that suffer from pathologies of multiple personalities. At that time, at the end of the 19th century and the beginning of the 20th. These movies reflect the mania for detachable heads coming from the theory surrounding hysteria, since it is because of the split between reason and the other higher faculties and the body, the lower faculties, that hysterical phenomena such as hallucinations and automatism happen. Méliès cinematic tricks such as stop motion substitution, double exposure, masking, dissolves, made it possible to represent the fantasies of hysterics, and the spectators could see and feel what it was to be a hysteric. Méliès, the frenetic gestures and contortions of certain Méliésian roles did remind spectators of epileptics and hysterics, and all these people afflicted with tics, limbs, and other pathologies of movement. But more than that, the nervous body, as performed in the context of these attractions, gave the public the opportunity of testing these symptoms that were in vogue at the end of the 19th century without putting their own health at risk, unlike those who suffered really from clinically proven hysteria. We can imagine that spectators themselves took pleasures in the spectacles of the grotesque, the deformed, and the mentally defected. Let's watch a little movie, L'Omnibus des Toqués, again from Georges Méliès, who deals with the bodies of foolish protagonists. Be it on stage, on the silver screen, or in performance halls, individuals could test mental and physical disorders by observing their effects upon others while resting secure in the knowledge that what they were watching was but a harmless imitation of madness. I come to my second point about the hysterical spectator. The imaginary of the nervous body can also be found in psychological and medical literature as well. It is thus necessary to also examine this paradigm in texts that conceptualize the experience of spectators perceived variously as hysterical or hypnotized subjects or both. In fact, one can note that many sources define the spectators of moving pictures as nervous bodies exposed to the influence of the movies, which resulted in the triggering of mimetic reflexes, automatisms, hallucinations, quivering, and eye problems. Reflecting upon the possible effects of film projected onto luminous screen in a dark and poorly ventilated theater, which was potentially conducive to vice, some observers of the cinematograph associated the change induced by modernity in people's living conditions and the development of nerve disease. Not only did the cinematograph become a space of neurotic agitation, but it became the materialization of the frenzy imposed by the metropolis. Contemporary observers did not hesitate to draw a parallel between the hustle and bustle of the city and the agitation of the cinematic universe, the nervous body being the mediating factor between the former and the latter. Here you have a source of Dr. Marguerite, which I did not translate it, but he talks about precisely this topic and the trepidations of the movie images, also on the level of representation. The cinematic spectator was very often depicted either implicitly or explicitly as a hysterical subject, whether one wanted to condemn filmic projections or assert the novelty of a medium that transported its audience in a whirlwind of new sensations. In other words, the hysterical spectators could be seen from two different perspectives, depending on the positions and the ideological leaning of the commentators. As far as discourses stigmatizing cinema are concerned, many a text drew a parallel between the convulsions of the hysteric and epileptic body and those of the spectator. all. For instance, according to René Dumic, the cinematograph did nothing but damage both the aesthetic taste and the physiology of the spectator facing dancing images and protagonists subjected to hysteria. In this particular text, the author talks about phenomena such as convulsions, illusion of reality, agitation, and automatism, referring to images as well as to the bodies of spectators. The kind of movie that he seems to depict is probably a slapstick movie where the acting is characterized by the gesticulations, jolts, disjointed movements and trembling of a body that has become mechanical and mimetic. Let's see The Monkey Race, a slapstick movie from 1909. And probably the movie was recorded a bit accelerated, in an accelerated pace, in order to underline the hectic gestures and movements. The speed at which the characters move, the frantic succession of images, and the repeated impact of the stimuli all echo the disorders which afflicted hysterics who were powerless to control an anarchic body entirely taken over by reflex activity. Another source, written by Enrico Tovez, explains to the reader that thank to the mechanical speed of modern machines, the cinematograph transports the spectators at the speed of a car on a racetrack from cause to effect. The films offered indeed viewers an experience that abolishes the boredom of having to think, relieving the fatigue that comes with reasoning and inhibits the control of instincts by logic, hurling them into the agitation of a life that is better than the real thing a lot of reviews emphasize the frantic rhythm of cinematographic images passing before the eyes of spectators who were themselves carried away by these rapid-fire movements. Commenting in an article on a trick film that was screened at a slightly accelerated pace in order to reinforce the impression of an epileptic movement, the journalist Gustave Babin underlined the power of a dispositive capable of engendering a sensation of vertigo, bringing one to the threshold of lunacy. Thus, in film, an accelerated motion would appear precipitated, quasi-epileptic, like in a nightmare. I propose to watch a clip from a movie called Onésime Horloger, which deals precisely with the topic of acceleration of modern life using a comical stance. Onésime is a very famous comic figure of the French early cinema. And he's going to manipulate a sort of time machine that regulate the rhythms of modern life. This movie shows the fascination for speed, constant agitation, hectic, hysterics movements, and body language. The high speed of the cinematographic machine and of filmic representation itself influence in a significant way the way modernity and especially the rhythm of urban life imposed upon Western societies was perceived. Canudo, an Italian critic, sees, for instance, cinema as a modern art defined by convulsion, speed, and action. For the hectic speed at which shot scenes and characters followed each other was reminiscent of the rhythm of modern life. And what neurotic suffered from was precisely an excess of sensitivity with their bodies that were vulnerable to the slightest exterior or inner stimulations, their contortions and contractures being a pathological extension and amplification of the normal functioning of the modern subjectivity. In other words, the body of the movie spectator, as well as the movie actor, had much in common with the hysteric. However, in order to further delineate the shapes of this nervous body, it is necessary to take into account yet another component, namely hypnosis, which was to enjoy an unprecedented success after having been scientifically rehabilitated around the year, the end of the 19th century by Jean-Martin Charcot, who did so in order to use it as a tool in the context of experiments and observations centered on hysterical disorders. So I come to my last point, the hypnotized spectator. The medical and psychological theories of hypnosis and suggestion provided authors who were seeking to describe the cinematic experience in terms of an irresistible influence exerted on the spectators by moving images with a series of concepts and representations. The way they depicted it made a film look like it possessed hypnotic powers, cinema itself becoming a magnetic dispositive within which film played the part of the hypnotist. The magnetic power of cinema chained the subject at once to the representation unfolding before his or her eyes and to all the other spectators who were seen as an easily suggestible group of people. In this way, cinema was targeted by moralizers who were concerned about the influence it might have on young people, in particular. And the argument of the suggestibility of the spectator brought about by moving images became a topos in discourses voicing anxiety over the possibility that they might trigger mimetic instincts likely to jeopardize public order and security. From around 1910 and onwards, a whole series of surveys on the negative effects were conducted, particularly by groups of educators, psychologists, and criminologists who pondered on cinema's power of suggestion. These discourses were especially concerned by the impact of cinema on so-called vulnerable subjects, namely children, teenagers, and women, who might be tempted to mimic examples of inappropriate behavior seen on the screen. According to many observers who commented on it, cinema was the medium that exerted the most powerful suggestive and unconscious effects, as shown in this text by the Italian psychiatrist Guglielmo Mondio, who asserted that cinema was the most dynamic means of suggestion and persuasion ever known to mankind. Tapping the classical vocabulary of suggestion and its derivatives, certain authors frequently use the metaphor of hypnotic fluid that brings to mind the mesmerian origins of hypnosis. Significantly, Edouard Poulain made use of the electrical imaginary of the neurotic body in the following passage where he deals with the hypnotic effect of cinema. Convinced, so he depicts an anecdote about young people using cinema in order to provoke disorders, social disorders. And he used the metaphor of the hypnotic fluid. Other psychiatrists and lawyers were also trying to criticize a leisure that might generate great fears, emotional shocks, or pathological exaltation of the imagination among especially young spectators. And it's the case of, for instance, Halbert and Helwig and Robert Gaup. According to them, children suffered the most from the negative influence of cinema and especially of the Schoen film, a cinematographic genre that was seen as amoral, vulgar, sensationalistic, so in one word, bad movie. By watching films with scenes where crimes were committed, children were exposed to the risk to imitate bad behaviors, skewing their sense of right and wrong. The sensationalism of the bad movies might even encourage them to commit all sorts of felonies and even crimes. To make his point, Helvig gives the example of a farm boy who had murdered the 4.5-year-old son of his employer for no apparent reason. And the fact of the matter was that the murderer, who wasn't known to have any sadistic tendencies and was considered to be a normal teenager, was a movie buff and had supposedly seen two films with scenes resembling, it was said, to the murder of the little boy. The criminal was thus accused of having imitated actions he had seen in films, the whole incident being seen as a textbook case about the unconscious impact of movie viewing. Thus, most of this statement expressing fear about the adverse impact of movie projection on certain categories of spectators were underpinned by the idea that madness may be contagious. Hence, warning about the hypnotic effect of film were rooted in theories about the mimetic instinct and the contagiousness of bodily movement. The spectators was seen as exposed to the risk of reproducing what he saw or she saw on the screen. I come to my conclusion. What are the conclusions that we can draw from this consideration regarding the nervous body of spectators of early cinema, a spectator who oscillates between two complementary states, namely hysteria and hypnosis? I would like to focus on two points. First of all, as we have seen, the condemnation of the cinematograph induced a pathological theory about spectators reduced to automatic and unconscious body. However, this theory should be relativized since filmic projection openly welcomed spectators delighted by the spectacle they were being offered. The hypnotic captivity is thus an enchantment that is more joyful than morbid. While others fear its dire repercussions, the result of the extraordinary power of attraction the silver screen exerts on the masses has been described by the French-Swiss critic Émile Villermoz as a state of happy and unconscious slavery. The dimension of pleasure, emotion, and laughter inherent to the very first film screenings is an indicator of the intended audience of a programming that was at once eclectic, but most of all, exciting. Far from engendering meditation or contemplation or suffering, the cinematograph filled audience with enthusiasm while overwhelming them. Aiming at the body rather than the mind, the cinematograph demanded vivacious and reactive spectators who were at once mimetic and empathetic. But it also called forth spectators who surrendered themselves to the joys provided by their automatic and regressive bodies. Like hysterics and people who have been mesmerized, the spectator of early cinema is characterized by its instability, its mimetic faculties, and its fragmented identity. Secondly, we need to specify that the nervous body is a figure that was particularly prevalent during the early years of filmic projections and epitomized a moment in time when cinema had almost no norms and remained open to many possibilities. The spectator of the cinematograph is a relatively undetermined, nomadic and changing subject, which houses contradictory and fluctuating sensorial, perceptive and emotional regimes. until 1915-1916, cinema addressed a mimetic and suggestible subject which is open to all manner of exterior and inner influence. So even if this conception of a spectator who is receptive to a certain form of hypnosis and hysteria took precedence during the early years of cinema, in the 1910s, it was progressively replaced by a new model of spectatorship, namely by a spectator who is more quiet, more silent, more educated, more disciplined. The reform of cinema that took place in the 1910s aimed at the repression of the nervous spectator, which interacted too actively with the screen and the other viewers. What was feared above all was the development of a subjectivity that extended its powers beyond the limits of the individual body so as to embrace its immediate surroundings. With its enhanced sensitivity, the nervous body indeed interacts with the outside world to the point of merging with it. And that was obviously a problem for the dominant ideologies. The new model of spectatorship that came into being in the 1910s and most of all in the 20s, vanquished this nervous ego so as to offer a more mature and disciplined ideal of reception dictated by the demands of the by then booming cinema industry, which needed to attract spectators from the middle and the upper classes. But that's another story. Thank you.